You're listening to Mad Radio.
Mad Radio.
Mad Radio. Make a difference.
Quick, me lads! Hoist the rigging!
Aye, Captain!
Splice the main brace!
Aye, Captain!
Batten down the hatches!
Aye, Captain!
I'm going below deck to get the show started. Cursed coast of the Caribbean, the pompous prince of pig legs, Brandon McCarty.
Thank you, Petey. Welcome in, all you scallywags, you swashbucklers, landlubbers, horn swogglers, and salty dogs, to the Peg Leg Podcast, a show where we delve into the lives of fellow pirates and learn a bit more about the unsung heroes among us all.
Arr!
This week, we travel all the way to the top. That's right, to speak with an individual who currently serves as the president of the Modesto Junior College. Before that, he was the president of Columbia College back in July of 2018. He's also a first-generation immigrant. He has earned a PhD and MBA from Ohio University. He taught computer programming and worked in the private sector in India, specializing in consumer behavior and market research. In his spare time, he enjoys the company of his cats. I'll ask about that. His leisure activities include following world news, cryptocurrency, getting to know cultures through his travels, and adventure sports. He was a member of Western India Paragliding Association and enjoys solo flights. And he's tried his hand, or feet, that is, in scuba diving, white water rafting, high altitude hiking. This guy does it all. He also enjoys skiing, although, by his own admission, he's not very skilled. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the poop deck, Santanu Bandyopadhyay. Did I say that right?
You did.
Oh, boy, I have been practicing that for an hour.
You did well. You did better than my wife of 22 years.
Very good. Well, sir, so spin us up on where you're from and how you got here.
Oh, man. That's a long story, and where do I begin? Well, I was born in a place which is about halfway around the globe. Whichever way you travel from California, it takes about 10,000 miles to get to India.
Okay.
I was born in the eastern Indian city of Calcutta, which is also known as the City of Joy. That's
really?
Where I born. Yes, I born, I grew up, my college education, everything was there, and I was a student of physics in my college days. And when I graduated, I realized that, you know, I don't have that kind of love for physics that I can be a physicist. So after graduating from college, I did not go for a master's degree. I went on and did some work in the banking industry. I was with American Express Bank for some time in India back in the day. They paid very well. The way money was good, job sucked.
Right. I'm sure that there's a lot of us who fit into that that category.
Right?
Yeah.
And then I changed my career from there, and I went to teaching computer. And those of you who are old enough to remember COBOL programming, I used to teach COBOL programming back in the day. I did a little bit of coding in Pascal and Fortran and those kind of things, which were before Microsoft Word and before Google and before all of those kind of things that we are familiar with now. I used to teach DBase 3 and Lotus 1-2-3 also. That was back in the 90s.
My goodness.
Now, working there, teaching, it was very satisfying. It was interesting, and money sucked. So it's like coming from one side to the other side, and where is the balance? And then I got into an advertising firm. That was the fastest growing ad agency in India at that time. And I was their research director. Like every ad company needs somebody who find out the research. And I'm talking about the pre-internet days. So what we are doing is when we launch a product for a client, we advertise in radio, in television, in print media, in newspapers. And once an ad is launched, we quickly assess the market, see where the response is good, and then reorient our campaign. How well do your research? And those researches need to be done probably over the course of a weekend, so that we have time to readjust our marketing campaign. If you do a good research, you get a bonus. If you do bad research, you lose a client, you write another resume and find another job.
Oh. So how did you do the research that quickly then? Especially back then.
We had a team, and we would have team in multiple cities. So whenever an ad is launched, our teams would go out to the streets, and they would literally stop people and ask them. We would do the vox pops, asking that, did you see that ad of that soap? Do you remember this scooter ad? Do you do this? What do you recall? And we would have the both aided recall, unaided recall, getting into the customer's mind. So consumer behavior research, that was our fundamentals. And we literally, I kid you not, we literally spent 16-hour days, oftentimes sleeping in the office itself. So it was a very high-stressed time, that 2-3 days or 7 days that we would spend. But a lot depended upon that, because if you can get the pulse of the market, then you reorient the campaign. More TVs, or this ad is working, that selling point goes. And we realized that you, new, and free, those are the three things that everybody likes. But how you package that and how do you communicate that, that matters a lot. So that was my background. I did that for about 9 years or so.
And now most of that can just be found on Facebook. It's just a little ad that pops up, right? Bing.
Yes. But again, I mean, now we have lots of technology.
Right.
But when you look at the human psychology and mentality of it, that has not changed. And there are also some kind of cultural affinity towards advertising that does not change. Like if you think about a difference between a city person and a rural person, what appeals to a rural person would not appeal to a city person, and vice versa. So if you're selling a car for a rural person, a truck, an ability to carry load, those things, ability to carry large surface area, that's important. A city guy, a swanky car, a show-off, a value that's envy of your neighbor. Yes, that makes sense. So if you're selling a product, again, what characteristics would you highlight? Which media? How do you project it? Like, say, if you look at whiskey ads, they are always associated with men in black ties, corridors of power. What has a drink got to do with corridors of power? But the image and imagery is that the image of a whiskey, image of a fine scotch, you always associate that with men of power for whatever reason. There is absolutely no reason between taste of a scotch whiskey and somebody who has reached a big position in life. There is no association.
Interesting.
But, you know, cigarette ads, again, it's a lifestyle ad. Marlboro Man, that quintessential image that we had in the 60s and 70s. A real macho man is like a Marlboro Man and a horseback and a lasso. What has tobacco got to do with that? Nothing. So anyway, I did that for about 9 years. And then I was thinking at that time that, first of all, my training was in physics. I did unstructured learning on the streets, but I wanted to do some structured learning. Also, when I was in the ad agency, what I would do is I used to backpack extensively in India. So when a campaign runs, the 16-hour days that goes off, and I would tell my boss, and those were the non-cell phone days, or just cell phones are coming up at that time, and tell him that, you know what, I'm off, I'm going out to the backcountry. When I come back maybe a couple of weeks. And if I don't come back, I can get killed by the bear or tiger or whatever, mauled by a lion, find another researcher. And that is the time that I thought that, you know, there's so much to see in the world. I wanted to travel out. I wanted to see more. And one way of doing that was to come to USA, pursue my education further. Plus, when you talk about the exchange value, a dollar takes you much longer than a rupee. So that's when I decided to come to USA. That was 98, 99. Dot-com bubble was at its biggest. Economy was great. Demand for MBA was all-time high. That was the time I started planning for it. I prepared for it. I got admission into different institutions. And I chose Ohio University because they were offering a one-year full-time MBA program. I had to clear 90 quarter credits in 1 year's time. But then again, somebody who is coming in mid-career, it was a dual deal for me, because if it's a shorter period of time, I pay less in fees and I get back to the job market quicker.
Okay. So you didn't really have a social life at all for about that year.
Well, my last name, as you know, is Born to Party.
Well, I'm glad you found some some time to still relax.
No, when you think about it, I came here on the sixth day of the sixth month, 6th of June, 2000. I had 6 suitcases. I was married to my current wife for 6 days. My son was, my stepson, he was about 6 years old at that time. And I had $6,000. So 6 is my lucky number.
Wow, okay.
And that was the first time that I came out of the Indian subcontinent. I traveled a lot in Indian subcontinent, but never really came to the Western world. And when you come here, it's like that extended honeymoon period. Everything is so good. The roads are clean and things mm-hmm. work and blah, blah, blah. Come in here, and as I said, that I got into Ohio University. I ran through my 90 quarter credits for the next, for one summer and full term, full 3 terms. Completed everything. 2001, August, I graduated. My goal at that time is get your degree done, go back to New York or Chicago or Miami and work for J. Walter Thompson. That was the goal. 3 weeks into my graduation, 9/11 happened. The world changed. And when you call a recruiter with a last name like Bandyopadhyay, all you hear is a click on the other side of the line.
Right.
Difficult times. And I remember at that time I was talking to my wife also that should we just pack our bags and go back? And what am I doing here? I was that invisible person, which many of our students see themselves in, that I'm here in the room and I'm not here in the room. At that time, one of my colleagues, one of my professors, that he said that, why don't you try working in an institution of higher education? They are less judgmental. And that's when I also realized how much power somebody in an institution of higher education has. That statement, that encouragement, and that support changed the course of my life. From being desperate, thinking of going back to India, to I thought that, yeah, I see a glimmer of hope out there. I came to higher education. I said, I know nothing about higher education. How do I work there? He said, you know what? You understand statistics. Statistical analysis is same. Standard deviation is calculated the same way. I said, yeah, but I don't have any domain knowledge of higher education. Did you learn? You are a learner. You got to do that. So I applied for a job, and my first job in higher education was a budget and policy analyst in Ohio University. An institution, that time they had about a $400 million budget, and I would do the analysis of budgets and see how their fiscal side is associated with their priorities and their strategic goals. And then I would put my report to the vice president and he would take it to the board and so on and so forth. The discovery that I had when I started working in higher education is this is a highly collaborative industry. What I mean by that is in advertising world, we were highly competitive. If I have some advantage, I would never tell you my competitor because I would encash that advantage and make money out of it. In higher education, if you find out something, what do?
You share it.
Yes, you go to the next conference and say, hey, I figured it out. You want to know from me?
Yes.
Here's my lecture. So that's a collaboration. And that competitiveness to collaboration, I started liking this animal. Collaborative learning is different. I personally witnessed what's the power of higher education in changing the track of my life. And that's when I thought that, you know what? How about I learn more about this institution? So I enrolled in a PhD program in Ohio University. I worked full-time, and I did my PhD program, and I got more and more interested and intrigued in higher education and its power of changing lives. And I thought that, yeah, I did pay my bills by selling alcohol and tobacco. That's one way of living life. I can pay my bills by encouraging people to be successful in their lives. That's probably a more satisfying way of life.
Right. The other one may be more entertaining, but certainly, you know, for the short run, right?
Right. So when I was in the middle of my PhD program, that time, again, another faculty member of mine said, hey, there's this community college close by, about 60 miles away from where I used to live in Athens, Ohio. They're looking for a director of research. Why don't you try there? I applied. I got the job. And that was the institution, Zane State College. They were a part of an national initiative called Achieving the Dream. This was in 2005. Achieving the Dream was focused on students of underrepresented minorities who come here And our research was focused on what is necessary that they can achieve their dreams in a college. What are the points of disconnect? How we can make them more successful? Zane State College was a very unique campus. 2,000 students, middle of Appalachian, Ohio, the poorest, one of the poorest counties in the United States. At the coal times, when the coal mining was there and all that, so on and so forth, from West Virginia, they were okay.
Right.
But then times changed, lives changed, and they still wanted to maintain that small rural area, and the economic engines were gone. Yet, with that supremely challenged background areas, and we had 70% of our students in Pell, 90% first generation in college, our graduation rate was twice the national average.
They were hungry.
They were hungry, and then our president at the time, Dr. Brown, he had this line for the college. He said, we treat every student with a personal touch. Because it was 2,000 student campus, we could really do that, enact that personal touch in everything that we do, from the classroom to outside the classroom. We knew our students. We supported them. We supported them in all possible ways. And that really helped them in college and ended up making them successful. I learned a lot as a part of that Achieving the Dream initiative. Got an opportunity of working with these big league names in community college system like Kay McLeaney, Byron McLeaney, Tom Bailey, who was not a star at that point of time. Now Tom Bailey is a star. Everybody knows about him. Davis Jenkins. So we had lots of research work, and we got together many times. I remember writing this initial set of questions for Survey of Entering Student Engagement, SENSE, which is now a national survey from SESI and NESI's table. So we were there, and that those 4 years was really satisfying in uncovering what do we need to do to help our students succeed. And that's probably a very gratifying time for me also, to know that how much we can do and how much we have the power of changing lives, how we can bring that. In the meantime, I completed my doctorate degree, earned my degree, and I was getting tired of shoveling snow in Ohio.
How much snow are we talking?
Well, I'm from a tropical country. So although yes. I traveled in the Himalayan region in India and upper altitude hiking and all that stuff, but in general, I have summer and extreme summer, two seasons. Here in Ohio, southeastern Ohio was peculiar. The first snow would hit the ground before Thanksgiving. Last snow can be there in as late as in April. But sometimes that Arctic wind would come from Cleveland, from the lake areas, dump a ton of snow, and then the southern Gulf wind would come, melt the snow away. So it is not like Chicago that once you get the snow, it's all piled up there. But yes, there are snow times when there would be level 3 emergency, which means if you go outside without any reason, you would be arrested.
Wow.
Yeah, because roads are so dangerous that if you go out and you get yourself in a ditch or something, you are wasting public resources. So if you don't have any reason to go out, like you're a life-saving profession or something, you're not supposed to go out. Stay put. So I was getting tired of that, and my wife said that, you know what, let's get out of Ohio. And she gave me a brief. She said, I want to be close to a big city, but not in a big city. I want to be close to the skiing slopes and close to the ocean. I want to be in a multicultural environment. And I want to be a place which is not snowing.
Okay.
Plug in all these factors.
Yes.
The only place that you have in the United States or in the world is Southern California.
Yes. Yeah.
I was lucky enough. I applied for some jobs, and I got a job in Cypress College as the director of research and planning. Came here, started the job, great campus, loved it, no shoveling snow, fighting in the traffic, but slowly I started getting adjusted with that. And 3 years in Cypress College in that position, they opened up the position of executive vice president in charge of both instruction and student services.
Okay.
I applied for that position, and again, somebody trusted in me and offered me that position. So I went on to be the executive VP for 5 years in Cypress College, handling both instruction and student services. During that period, it was a great time. My boss, the president at the time, Bob Simpson, great man, great vision, and my other colleague, Karen Kant, we were a good team. We would challenge each other. We would go out. We would argue with each other, and we would get things done. Cypress ended up becoming the number one college in California in 2015 when we were there. So that was a great moment for us. We built some programs. We helped the students. One thing to another. And, you know, 2018, 5 years in that job, I thought that I should be taking, unless you're the lead dog, the scenery never changes. So from executive VP, how about getting into a presidency? And presidencies, it's restricted by numbers. It's not always you choose where you want to go. I have already traveled 10,000 miles from my home. So another 500 miles does not make much of a difference. I applied. I got the job in Columbia College. That's how I ended up in Columbia in 2018.
And so that had to be a little different, right, from where you had been down south to go into the foothills.
You know, I keep saying that I changed my country many, many times.
Yeah.
Bombay to southeastern Ohio, that was a genuine change in country. Southeastern Ohio to Southern California, again, seems like changing my country. And Southern California back to foothills.
Yes.
It's like this. When I was in Zane State College, Zane State was about 95% Caucasian. So I was the moving diversity in my campus. Out of 2,000 people, I think we had 3 African-American students. And I was the only brown guy. When I came to Southern California, I lost that because everybody looks different.
Right.
Who cares where are you from? You know, there is so much of mixing of race and culture and ethnicity. In Southern California, everything is accepted. From then, when I came to Columbia, again, I come back from a very multicultural atmosphere to a 93% Caucasian population. I remember my first week in Columbia, summertime, so things were done. I went for a run around the campus, beautiful location. So I'm in my shorts and tees, and I'm pumping gas in the gas station and talking on the phone to my wife. The lady on the next bay looks at, "Hey, you're the new president at the college, right?" I'm like, "That's not tattooed on my forehead. How do you know?"
You were the only brown guy in town.
Pretty much, yeah. But the way the community treated me and the way we could talk to each other, mm-hmm. I could see the respect. I could see how people are people anywhere. When you go somewhere and you treat people with respect, they reciprocate back. And that was another learning that I may not understand their lifestyle. It's necessary for me to understand where they are coming from, what's important for them. I remember on behalf of Rotary, I went out to chop wood because we would supply wood to the veterans. Now, I have never seen a wood bifurcating machine. I'm like, I have no clue how to do that. And somebody taught me how to do that because it's dangerous. It can chop off your fingers.
Absolutely.
And whatnot. So I learned that part. Then I remember this guy, he told me, "Oh, when you're loading those things, you mix the oak and the pines." I'm like, my mother never told me which one is oak and which one is pine. What's that? And he said that one is the denser wood, which would be the starter kind of a thing, and other is lighter wood, which burns. Now, you know, that is where the practicality and theory comes together. In my classroom, I studied physics. I know everything about British thermal unit, how to define that, all that stuff. I don't have the practical idea of how to light a fire.
Yeah.
And this gentleman who is educating me there, he may not have theoretically studied British thermal unit.
Right.
But he knows how much heat is necessary to heat up his home of what magnitude. So that's where our theoretical knowledge and practical knowledge need to come together. I really learned a lot there. I connected with the community and it was great. It was a great life. Then when MJC was looking for its president, there was a vacancy out there. The chancellor invited me that, "Would you like to come here?" And I did both the colleges for some time. And then I was more focused on MJC because it's a large campus and it needs its dedicated leadership. Since then, I have been here. And last, 1.5 years or so? But MJC is unique. And I say that not just facetiously saying that everything is unique. MJC has been here for the last 100 years. Modesto is a 250,000 people city. It's a big, small town.
Yes.
It's a big town, 250,000 people. But when I take anybody at random at downtown Modesto and say, "Do you know about MJC?" 9 out of 10 would have some direct or indirect relationship with this campus. So emotional association with MJC is great in the campus and community. COVID has taken its toll. It has created different types of challenges. And what we are looking at is when we come back for fall, how do we bring this campus and community together? How do we coexist together? And not just civility on the books, but really rediscover there is a joy of sitting across somebody at the cafeteria, sharing a cup of coffee, having that water cooler discussions, enriching each other's lives, or at the end of the day, going for a glass of beer together. That's what we need to cultivate. Anxiety, COVID, yeah, everything is there. That's real life. But we cannot let that overwhelm us. We need to rediscover the joy of working.
Excellent. Well, I can't wait to get started on especially the fall semester, but certainly even after that as well. I think that things are going to really pick back up and we'll have a campus again. That'll be amazing. So what are some of your hobbies outside of your massively busy schedule, it sounds like?
Well, one of the things is we all need to have some outlets.
Yes.
I do enjoy running. Again, I'm not an athlete or anything of that sort. I follow running with the motto that you have to beat yourself before you beat others. So your pain, your exhaustion, and all those things, you have to overcome all of that. So that's what one thing I do. I try to run 4 to 5 days a week, if not more.
What's your mileage?
Oh, man, I suck. It's maybe 10-minute miles. That's what I do.
Okay, but well, for how long do you run?
How long do I run? I typically want to do anything between 2.5 to 3.5 miles per day. I don't do any more than that. I used to do longer, but now anything from 20 to 30 minutes. The days I'm really good, I feel good, maybe 40 minutes. But I don't remember when I exceeded more than 40 minutes in the last so many years. And also in Columbia College, we started a running club. So it was, I used to run with them. There were students, there were other employees. So it is, whether you are a manager or a dean or a classified employee or a student or a person, who cares? Just come and run.
That's right. You all sweat the same.
Yes, we all sweat the same. And there were a couple of runners out there. Oh my God, there's one of them still here in MJC, and that's Christian Million. So we would like to revive that running club one time in MJC when we all come back together. Maybe once in a week, we just go out and run the tracks or something. You know, just enjoy each other's company. And after running, then go out for a glass of beer or something. Let's revive those kind of joys and connections.
I may jump in on that. Possibly. We'll see.
Sounds good.
So what else besides running do you like to do?
Of course, everybody loves to travel.
Right.
But when I travel, I don't want to go to this resort kind of a travel and just sit there and see the inside of another Hilton, which I could have seen any part of the world. I like to enjoy the life on the street because I believe that is where truly a city lives. So wherever I go, I would like to go out and if health conditions permit, because now I have to be a little bit conscious about that, enjoy the street food, mix around with the locals. I may not speak the language, but see how they carry on with their lives. That's an interesting part. Like I was in Dominican Republic some time back, a couple of weeks back, and we went to Santo Domingo. And I realized that was the first city established in the New World. When Columbus was coming from Europe, stopped there. There's a 498-year-old church established there and their main town square. That's a fascinating place. Cobbled streets and all that and pigeons walking around. And you sit there for some time and watch the world go by. I think my most favorite pastime when I'm traveling is have a book, sit in the town square and preferably under a tree or something, leisurely, and watch the world go by. People watching, how people get along with their daily lives, that's interesting. So that's one thing that fascinates me. Whenever I travel, of course, seeing culture, that's another part that every place has its different aura and culture. And as a human being, when we want to relate to each other, we need to appreciate each other's culture. I mean, that's one thing that I see in the world. There is so much of a war that goes on. It seems most of the time we are having this cultural war. I hate you. I reject your culture. I do not like your way of life. Before rejecting something, it's necessary for us to understand that. Rejection is easy. Understanding is difficult. And I don't have to accept each and every part of somebody else's culture because my cultural norm are some values. But as a person, my life experience, I have become multicultural. I was born in India. I grew up there. I have some Indian roots in me, which I will carry to my grave. When I came to America, initially, I thought, you know, every American talks about beer and football. Life is so shallow. Because I was getting a pushback that my culture was not being appreciated. Nobody's talking cricket on the dining table. And slowly I realized that, yes, my culture has some values. American culture has some values. Like, say, for a simple thing, timeliness in American culture. In American culture, 7 o'clock means 7 o'clock. In some other parts of the world, 7 o'clock means somewhere around 6:30 and 7:30, or somewhere around 7 and 8. I like that part. Individualism versus collectivism. So I want to discover that and then see what are the different parts of culture that we can include in our own culture. So we become a multicultural existence. We recognize some. I may reject some of the other parts of the culture, but I don't have to hate it. So that's one part that I enjoy. Like different types of adventure sport. I have done lots of things like jumping off of a cliff with a pair of wings. I used to do paragliding.
Oof. Did you ever have any interesting close calls from that? Or?
Fortunately not, because I had an instructor who was very clear. He said that when you're driving a car, if you come to a crossing, you can stop your car. And you can see left, right, and decide which way you want to go. So when you're flying up there, you're flying at 20 knots. You may start keep thinking, but you are still flying because you're dependent upon the wind. You do not stop the wind. If you do not know which way you are going, you may soon be on a very rough terrain and you're forced to land. So plan. Have your route first. Know what it is. And he taught us one thing. Sydney was a great guy. He used to tell me, Santanu, that time I was 180 pounds. So you're 180 pounds. If you have to crash, crash close to the road so I don't have to carry you over the hill. He taught us one thing. He said that never undermine nature. You are thinking you are having a 32-foot sail. You are 180 pounds. You are invincible. You know what? This same Bernoulli's principle that flies a modern jet, that's... How many thousand pounds is that? And when a strong wind comes, they can just toss out that jet like nobody's business. So you are nothing compared to the power of wind. Respect that. See how you can work with that rather than challenging it. So that was a great sport in terms of understanding our limitations and understanding that how insignificant we can be when we talk about the natural forces.
So. My goodness. I don't know that I'm going to try that one. That's woof. So you've done some skiing as well. High altitude skiing, is that right?
Not high. I used to be a high altitude hiker.
Hiker, okay.
See, in India, when you're talking about, say, European peaks, Mont Blanc, 20,000 feet, 22,000 feet. In Himalayan region, unless you're 25,000 feet, you're not a hill. You're not a peak. You go to the upper Himalayan region, there are a number of peaks which are 25,000 feet or above. So getting up to 14, 15,000 feet is not a big deal. And that's where you kind of start your journeys in the Himalayan region.
So does that mean that you've done Mount Whitney down in...
I have not climbed Whitney here.
No.
I have not. No, okay. No. Probably I'll do that someday. But in Himalaya, many people don't know, the highest motorable road in the world, that's the Karakoram Highway, that's in upper Himalayan region, it goes at an altitude of about 20,000 feet. That's a motorable road. One of the coldest regions in the world happens to be in India, Pakistan, that border. It's called Aksai Chin. It's about, again, 20,000 feet. Six countries all drawing their guns there. I don't know why. There is India, there is China, there is Russia, there is Pakistan. Everybody's drawing their guns with their army and all that for that piece of land, which is infertile. Nothing lives out there. You cannot think straight. You cannot breathe straight. But that's one of the coldest regions in the world where human beings live. And we all fight over that piece of land because it's of strategic importance, so to say. But long story short, yeah, I used to go to the higher altitudes of Himalayan region, 14, 15,000 feet. And again, understanding the culture of the mountain people, that was so unique. Like when you walk around there and you stop there and the village guy would come and tell you stories, how you would see there is a little bit of a stillness in the air before the evening. That means the spirits, they're just coming there and then they would disappear in the stillness of night. Now, in a city living room, you can dismiss all those stories as superstitious and so on and so forth. But when you are sitting in one of those small little tea stalls in the upper Himalayan region with the dancing shadows on the walls and this old man is telling you the stories, there's a different type of romanticism in that. It was thoroughly enjoyable and I loved those experiences.
It's like a campfire. Almost.
It is. You know, that's another thing. You bring out a great point. Any culture that you look at, anywhere for the last 3,000-4,000 years of human life, what do? We light up a fire, we eat some food, we tell stories. And that is where we connect with people. That's where generations connect with generations. Somewhere we have to rediscover that joy. Whichever way. Now we have a little bit more sophisticated way of campfire, but still, fire, food, stories. Bring this back, man.
Fire, food, stories. Excellent. What is something that you pride yourself in?
I pride myself to be a human being. I try to be a good human being. Not that every day I'm successful, but I try to treat everybody with dignity and respect. I think that's the basic part, that to remain a human being, we all would have challenges in life. Challenges can be personal, challenges can be professional, challenges can be interactional. Whenever any challenge happens, our reactions kick in. We try to react to that situation. To remain calm in the face of any misfortune and to remain a human being and to treat everybody with respect, I think that's the supreme challenge. I try to do that. I'm not successful. We are all students and I'll be a lifelong learner in this, but I would like to better myself in that all the time. Another area that I would say that you folks should be able to judge that. I think we all need to listen first before talking. We all need to understand first before asking to be understood. And I try to do that. Again, I'm not saying I'm proud of that, but I would say these are all developmental courses of life, and we would develop throughout my life. I would develop throughout my life.
What do you find motivates you?
You know, if one image I can share, that is when I shake hands of the students who is walking across the stage on the commencement day. That is motivating. That's emotional. That's motivating. I remember this time when we had the graduation ceremony after 2 years. We shook hands of maybe 350, 400 students. And they came from all walks of life. I had this gentleman who was probably 80 years old walking with a cane. He doesn't need another piece of paper to get another job or anything, but it was that he wanted to accomplish. So when he comes up, that joy that he has accomplished something and we could be a part of that journey, that is the most motivating part. There was one lady who was crying all through the 2 hours of graduation. She said, I never imagined this day would come in my life. How cool is that? No amount of bonus check would bring you that joy that you see in the joy of people. When we see the students coming in, there was one student who came up to me after graduation and said, hey, can I take a selfie with you? And I told him, yeah, $5 is my modeling fees. You know, where do you get that much respect? Where do you get that much accomplishment? So when we think about that, yeah, we all have our pluses and minuses in our jobs. Most of the days, I feel that I have a great job. And some days, like everybody else, I feel I don't get paid enough.
Well, so what is it that you like about the MJC community as a whole?
What I like about the MJC community is there's a lot of investment, a lot of people who have been here, not only for their life, but for generation, and they want MJC to be successful. Our definition of how we can accomplish that success may be different, but their heart is in the right place. And I think it's like this, that if I consider my role to be the conductor of an orchestra, and we have got this 100 hands, I cannot tell the piano player how you play your instrument. If I can manage that whole part so that the whole orchestra, when it's in full bloom, That's like sipping a fine Scotch whiskey.
Mm.
Bring that joy out. So that is where I think MJC brings in, that there are many people who are invested in MJC for generations. They want this place to be successful. How I can harness that power so that we all can flow in the same direction. And yes, there are some days when it would not happen. There would be conflicts. And conflicts necessarily are not bad things. And there are conflicts of technicality, and there are conflicts of perspective. Technicality conflict, that's more laws and regulations. But even in conflict of law, yeah, those are straightforward. But conflicts of perspective, that is what help us thrive as an academic institution, contrasted to in my ad agency before, which was a very linear structure. The boss says this, you do this. Here, I'm the president, but not necessarily I'm the supreme boss or I'm the Mr. Know-All. I learn from people. One can come and challenge me. We put all the perspectives on the table, and we see how different perspectives make us whole. So again, navigating those challenges, those are the good parts that we see in MJC, that people are so invested. They come up. Number of people come up and say that, hey, you know what, this is something that we can do. Or this is what you have been doing. Why don't you do it this way? I love those conversations. I love that energy. And also, in my short stint, what I have recognized is how much this city of Modesto wants MJC to thrive. How much of hunger is there and appetite is there? Because we are going through this transformative phase. I was a part of Stanislaus 2030, where we're talking about by 2030, if we have to economically thrive this region, what do we need to do? Because we were an agriculture-based community that does not necessarily create all the jobs that we need or the well-paying jobs that we need. How do we create the well-paying jobs? Bring the well-paying jobs here. And we are estimating we need probably about 40 plus thousand well-paying jobs paying $28 an hour or more by 2030 to lift half of our population, half of our children born here out of the poverty line. Now, we have to be planning for that. We have to be preparing for that. And an educational institution has a large role to play in that area. All the interest that I have amongst the staff, amongst the community in MJC, that is really, really a great feeling that we are in this together.
Right, that we can be the feeder, if you will, right, into these companies that that should show up.
Yes.
Interesting. Wow. So within the city of Modesto, we'll call just Modesto, where are some of your favorite places to eat?
Oh, man. There are plenty.
That's right. You're a multicultural experience kind of guy. So there's is there a kind of food that you'd really enjoy?
You know, I like spicy food. I'm a meat eater.
Okay.
There is a gyro place that's on Yosemite Boulevard. Yosemite and Claus. It's a small hole-in-the-wall place. But that gentleman makes best gyros in town. So I love that. Skewers is, of course, a great place. And I have never been disappointed with Skewers.
Okay.
Their drinks, I love their drinks. In fact, one time, it's funny, I had some of my friends from out of town, and we all went to eat there in Skewers. And one of our friends loved one drink. And we came back home, and she was like, you know, I really like that drink. I don't know how they made it. She called Skewers back and said, can you tell me how did you make it? And they were so nice. They said, okay, yeah, we'll give you the recipe.
Wow.
This is how you make it.
Huh, they didn't make her go back down and have a few more before they
spend
some more money. We'll give you the recipe.
Right? Yeah. So that's great. Then the other last time we ate somewhere right here in Carpenter, I'm forgetting the name. They had some great tri-tip sandwiches. Which one is that?
Is that Burley's?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Great tri-tip sandwiches. I love the beer in Commonwealth.
Okay.
Great
they
selection
have,
of
they
beer.
Have quite, yes, quite the selection,
yes.
Don't they?
Camp 4 is a different atmosphere altogether. So, again, great place to eat. Containment Brewery, looking at the big beer cans, I'm not a pool player, but seeing people playing pool and enjoying the conversation, that's another great place. Plenty of places in Modesto to eat.
Yes.
Yeah. Eat absolutely. And drink.
Well, you can probably find him at any of those locations during the week. So we'll be we won't tell you exactly where he is when he's there, but certainly, yeah, look for them when you're out and about. Share with us, if you will, a funny story or experience that you've had, either professionally or personally.
Huh. You know, this was when I just came to this country. I was probably 2 days old in this country, Athens, Ohio, university town.
Yeah.
I'm just fresh off the boat from India. So even now, I have a pretty thick accent. That time, I had a much thicker accent. And of course, I had difficulty in understanding the people from southeastern Ohio because of their accent. And when you first come from a country like India, which is a developing economy, whenever you see the food prices, you're always converting your currency. So, it's $3.75. In India, the exchange rate is 55 rupees. That is about 180 plus rupees. In 180 rupees, I can get a nice three-course meal in a great restaurant in India. And here, all I would get is a sandwich. Oh, my God. Anyway, so I get up to this counter, and this young college girl, she is there at the counter, and she says, can I have a sandwich, please? Sure. What kind of bread? Now, in India, I have brown bread and white bread. Here, I don't understand this. I said, wheat bread.
Okay.
And then she asked me, what kind of cheese? Now, in India, in those times, there was only one kind of cheese available. It was known by the company. The company was named Amul. So there was Amul cheese. That's all I knew. And I'm just looking at her. I'm like, what do you mean? And she rattles off the names like Pepperjack, Lumberjack, whatever, Swiss, Cheddar. Now, imagine this. If you are not exposed to this culture, if I say Swiss, what is the taste connotation of Swiss cheese? What is the taste connotation of Pepperjack?
Right.
Nothing for me. It means nothing. So I said, ma'am, I eat everything. And she's like, sir, it's your choice. I'm like, okay, Pepperjack. Next one. What kind of meat? I said, ma'am, I eat everything. Sir, it's your choice. She rattled off. I said, okay, so-and-so meat. And my tension is rising at that time. Now, how many questions do I have to answer to get a sandwich? And then she asks me, sir, what kind of dressing? I freaked out.
Yeah.
I'm like, lady, how hard does it get? All I'm asking is, I'm telling you, I eat everything. I need a sandwich. Can I get it, please?
Yeah.
And she says, it's your choice, sir.
Were you at Subway?
No, it was a deli restaurant.
Oh, okay.
And I said, what are my choices? And again, she rattles off ranch, blue cheese, Thousand Islands. Now, again, imagine, ranch is a place where you raise cattle. What is the taste of ranch?
Right.
I don't know. Thousand Islands. I said, ranch. Long story short, for the last 22 years, I have always dependent upon ranch dressing. I'd never try anything else.
Is that right?
I tried it. It worked out. Whenever anybody asks me, dressing, ranch.
So, did you have someone behind you in line that was waiting for you to make your... Oh, my gosh.
Hey, coming to a different country. Another day, around the same time, or maybe about 3-4 days later than that, I went to a McDonald's.
Okay, yeah.
First time getting into a McDonald's here. In India, McDonald's came before I left there. But McDonald's was not a random restaurant. In India, McDonald's was expensive. That was a fancy restaurant. Rich people would throw their kids' birthday parties in McDonald's in India.
Okay.
It is that kind of a place.
Hmm.
And there is no drive-thru in India because there is no place and not many people have cars, at least in those times. So there is no drive-thru. You go and eat. So I go to this McDonald's restaurant or whatever. And this guy at the first question is, for here or to go? I'm wondering, what kind of a stupid question is that? Where would I go? So I looked at him and I told him to eat. He's like, what? Then I felt a tap on my shoulder, the gentleman behind me. He said, he's asking you, do you want to eat here or you want to take your food and go somewhere? Okay, I get it. No, I want to eat here. So, you know, these are the cultural challenges. For here or to go, which is such a commonplace question in America.
Right.
Imagine somebody who has never seen a drive-thru restaurant. Why should I go somewhere? I come to a restaurant to eat. What do you mean?
Well, it's a good thing you had somebody to kind of help you through the...
Right?
Goodness gracious. Well, so who has been one of your biggest influences in your life, either professionally or personally?
Here, when I was looking for a job after my 9/11, I graduated and all that. When I had that conversation, I would not even say one individual, but this was one of the days that I was sharing with my friends, colleagues, my professors, faculty members from the university, saying that how desperate and rejected I feel, that I'm that invisible person, I'm almost packing my bags. And that time, that group talked to me to say that, you know, cry at a place. These are non-judgmental places. That was a life-changing moment. That is the power that educators have amongst people. If that was not there, I would not be here today. And that's public education and the public educators, how they can influence somebody, sometimes we don't recognize. One smile from us, one nod from us, one word from us to tell somebody, yes, you can, just hang in there, just try. That means much more. So that conversation is probably the biggest game changer for me in life. Other influences, I cannot even count them in my fingertips, how I have been blessed to get that. I come from a very non-traditional trajectory, that I was a consumer behavior and research guy coming into budget and policy analysis to my first job as director of research. The president at the college, Dr. Paul Brown. Paul is not here anymore. He passed away last year. But he trusted me. He said that, yes, you bring in this one. You can do this. So to get a consumer behavior guy, statistically strong, and a budget and policy analyst as the director of research, somebody has to trust in you. Paul trusted me. When I was applying for the job of executive vice president of instruction and student services, Dr. Simpson, the president at Cypress at the time, he believed in me. When I said, this is my vision for this, he trusted me. You know, those influences are enormous in our life. When somebody comes up and says that, yes, we believe in you, go for it. What is the power of that? And that is the power that we have. That is the power that we can empower our students and unleash that potential in them. Opportunities are not there everywhere, but talent is. I think if we can unleash those talents, we can provide those doors of opportunity, open those doors of opportunities, we have lived a blessed life. So yes, I cannot count my blessings.
If you had a free plane ticket to go anywhere in the world, where would you go and why?
Patagonia.
Patagonia?
Yes, end of the world.
All right. What would you do there?
I would just see the place. I'd just see the place, and I have seen the pictures and the visions and all those places. It is great. It's super. Probably I'll go there even without the free plane ticket. I'll pay for the plane ticket and go there. But yeah, Patagonia is definitely one place that I would love to go. I'm planning to go there sometime. Don't know when the day will come. But then there is a whole list of places that I would like to go.
Now, do you own any Patagonia jackets or anything?
No.
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 None. It's okay. I had to ask that question. Now, I think I've asked you before if you were a music person, so I'll ask this, but I kind of already know the answer. If there were three albums that you had to listen to for the rest of your life, that was it, only three albums, what albums do you think that those would be and why?
Pavarotti, Dalla, or Caruso? Yeah, that's one. The raw emotion, that's Italian. I don't speak any Italian whatsoever. But whenever he sings that number comes up, it brings out the raw emotion. It brings out that power. So I definitely, that would be one. Other one is more Indian connection. It is called, who is that? M.S. Subbalakshmi. That's more like a temple music. And there's a story behind this music. One day, I was playing that music in my backyard. My wife does lots of gardening. This is in Southern California. And one of our friend's son, two doors down, he's American. He does not understand any of the Indian languages. He comes and helps my wife. And they do gardening together. He was there listening to that. After about half an hour, he said, "Oh, that's really soothing. Which language is that?" And that's a Southern Indian language which I don't speak. So I also don't understand the language, but the tune. So M.S. Subbalakshmi would be another one. And the third one is, difficult to say. I love opera.
Okay. So
any of the piano, that'll be the third one.
Have you been to any opera performances or
yes.
plays?
Yes.
Is there one in particular that you like?
Difficult to say because it's each of them bring out their best and worst at some times. So I used to go quite regularly at LA Opera. Dorothy Chandler is a great pavilion out there, great place. Only thing is it's a lot of effort to make it to get there and all that. But once you do that, it's absolutely worth it. Rigoletto is one that I really like. Magic Flute is another that I loved. So Carmen, that was great. The Power of Carmen, that was, yeah.
Well, do you have any parting words of encouragement?
I don't know whether I am in that position to say that I encourage anyone, but I would always say that, you know what? I am what I am because of public education, because of the encouragement that I have received. I would have never dreamt when I came here as a first-generation immigrant with $6,000 in my pocket that I would become a college president of a campus which is 100 years old, which changes lives of thousands of people in course. A lot of things are possible. Have an open mind, and if you need any help, never shy away from that. You do not know what quarter the help can come from. Ask for help. Seek help and see how you can better yourself. And whenever that call comes, be prepared to pay forward. I never say pay it back. I'm not paying back anything. I have received much more than I can pay back in my lifetime, in my 10 lifetimes. But if I can pay it forward to somebody, if we can change some lives, that'll be great.
Thank you very much, Dr. B, for being here. And
thank you so much for this opportunity. It's great talking about where we come from. It's great to know each other. And, at the core level, we are all human beings. Our supreme challenge is misfortunes would come, situations would happen. To stay a human being, to try to understand before trying to be understood, that's where we all need to aspire for. So thank you for this opportunity.
Well, the winds are picking up and the barnacles are collecting on the bow. That means it's time for us to set sail, me hearties. This episode was brought to you by the letter R. R! And produced by yours truly. Editing duties were brought to you by Patchy the Parrot. And music by the Pirates Who Don't Do Anything. If you have any questions, comments, or concerns, remember you can reach us at peglegpodcast@gmail.com. And just a reminder, keep your booty close and your sword sharp, lest you find yourself swabbing the deck on the bottom of Davy Jones's locker. Until we meet again.